He had no worldly benefit from it. Neither would he bother about power, to be honest with you. But this worry and concern that he had for his brothers. I'm giving you an example of a non-Muslim. There was a time when Muslims or Muslim leaders used to feel the same way, or rather much more. Today, unfortunately, Muslim leaders, rather than taking care of their Muslim brothers, they bother about themselves. This is the truth. I'm not talking about leaders, I'm talking about we as individuals also. Everybody's become selfish. Everybody's bothered about their own power and what they will gain from it. Somebody's opening a charity organization. Allah knows best. For many people opening charity organizations, the intention is that I want to help my brothers. But the initial intention is, what am I going to gain out of it? What is it? What is that in for me? As an employment or whatever status, will I be recognized and so on. But Nelson Mandela was one individual, if you look into his biography, you will find that this was not his motive and intention. Rather, he wanted to liberate the people of Africa and he wanted to get rid of racism. Dear respected brothers, many people explain the reason why the diminution of Islam or the fall and declining of Islam. And people come out with different theories. Many people have mentioned different things. And they all in their own reason are explained. The majority of the mashayikh have mentioned the main cause of the fall of Islam, the declining of our deen, is because of disunity. Because we're disunited. One of the great sheikhs of the Indian subcontinent, known as Sheikh al-Hind, Maulana Mahmud al-Hasan, he was in prison for several years in Malta when he did jihad against the British. He was in prison. On his release, his students asked him, Sheikh, what did you learn from the imprisonment? He said, after great contemplation and great suffering and torture, which he went through, he said, I come to the conclusion that there's two reasons why there's great conflict, especially in India at the time, and throughout the Muslim world even then. He said, the two reasons why, which I understand are, the first, he said, myself and the Muslims have let go of the Qur'an Kareem. And himself was a mufassir. He wrote the tafsir of the Qur'an. But even then he said, I've let go of the Qur'an. And the second main thing he mentioned was, that's due to the disunity amongst ourselves. And he said, from today I endeavor that I'm not going to do nothing else but these two things. I'm going to grab hold and firm to the Qur'an. And second, I'm going to unite every single Muslim that I know. That was his intention. So this unity amongst Muslims is the cause of our diminution, unfortunately. You know, there was a time in our history that because of our being united, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Muslims and Islam victory. Take for example the Battle of Badr. Badr was the first great war that took place between the Muslims and the Mushrikeen. A great decisive war. Muslim soldiers consisted of about 300 odd Muslim soldiers or Muslims. And the Mushrikeen, and these were not equipped at all. Whilst the Mushrikeen had 1,000 well equipped with great transport. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory to these 300 Muslims. The main reason explained was because of the unity amongst themselves. And this is explained through an incident which took place when Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who is the flag holder of Islam, he says, a Sahabi narrates that his brother was captured. And Mus'ab ibn Umair was walking by, and his brother's eyes fell on Mus'ab ibn Umair. And he says, it looks like I've got a chance that I'm going to be released. Why? Because Mus'ab ibn Umair is in the Muslim army. So Mus'ab ibn Umair doesn't even look at his brother, walks past, and he shouts, brother, you know that I'm your brother, can you not see? He says, Mus'ab ibn Umair, to his brother, he says, you, my brother, and he said, I've been captured, can you release? He says, you're not my true brother, rather the one who's holding you in captivity is my brother. He said, the brotherhood between us is what? Iman and Islam. Every single person, and you know, fortunate, England or UK is such a country where the community is very diverse. Look in the masjid now, or every Jummah, or in every masjid almost, you will find people from different backgrounds. Pakistani, Bengali, Arab, so on. Go to Pakistan, Bangladesh, you'll find only Pakistanis, Bangladeshis, Indians, Arabs. But UK, like America and many other countries, is a country where there's a mixture of everyone. So it's more important for us that we unite amongst ourselves. Respected brothers, people have different languages. It doesn't matter. Allah Ta'ala has created it as such. People eat different food, wear different clothing. But that doesn't mean that they don't love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, the thing that's united us is Iman. And when this unity is formed, there's a great power within ourselves. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the example of mu'mineen and believers is that of a wall. A brick wall, one upon the other, cemented. Can anybody knock this wall or take in one brick out? No, they can't. Rather, the whole wall will fall. This is the example of brotherhood. You know, in the battle of Yarmouk, or the conquest of Syria, the Muslim army consisted of what? 35,000 men. And the leader was Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala. And the Romans consisted of 300,000. But Allah Ta'ala gave victory to the Muslims. And the narration explains that upon one occasion, Abu Huzaifa says that I went looking for my cousin. I thought I'd assist him, give him some water to drink. He said, I was walking by and I seen him on the floor, injured. So I took some water out and I said, here, have some. And he says, my brother next to me needs it more. He went to him and he said, that brother next to me needs it more. He says, I went past three of them, I came back to my own cousin. And I says, look, they don't want it. And I see that he's breathing his last and he passes away. Same to the second and the third, they all pass away without drinking the sip of water. Respected brothers, Islam is a religion of unity. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first thing that he did, and remember, the first thing ever to build a nation is to unite them. And the first thing ever to destroy a nation is to disunite them. And history testifies to this. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came a one man. He sent people to Medina, a few of them. But what did he do when he entered Medina himself? He paired one another and he created brotherhood between them. Abdurrahman ibn Auf radiallahu ta'ala says, I was paired with a Sahabi, Sa'd bin Abi Rabi'ah. And he said, the moment I was paired with him, he said, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I have great wealth. But did you know today Rasulullah has paired you with me? So you know half of my wealth, half belongs to you and half to me. He says, I have two houses. You can have one, and I'll have one. And even further, he says, I have two wives. You take one, and I take one. This is brotherhood. You know how far we are from these examples. Let alone giving your house to another brother. And you know, later on, when they were affluent enough, they could pay them off. And they did offer them. But they said, we gave it for the sake of Allah. We don't want no return. Today, let alone being a Muslim or a brother of Iman, our own relatives come from back home, poor third world countries, here, and what the first thing we do? Get on your feet and start working. This is how life is here. And at the same time, you have 3-4 properties, such a huge bank balance, can you not support this person for once in the beginning? Times are hard for him. You have 2 houses, can you not just forget giving him? Just stay to him for a year, brother, rent it for free. Has anybody ever done that? I'm talking about son-in-law here, let alone relationships. Blood relations don't do that for one another anymore. And this is Muhajirun and Ansar. Amongst them, a man, Ansar, doesn't never seen this Muhajir brother before, never. But the only thing he knows is that he has Iman inside him. And he says, take one of my house, take one of my wives, and take half of my wealth, subhanAllah. And today, unfortunate condition that we live in today, we can't even support our own brother. I'm talking about blood brother. It's very, very bad at the moment, unfortunately. You know, alhamdulillah, many of us that have come here, we have families here. Extended families. You know, if we ever thought to ourselves that how do we support one another, you know, this mortgage business you can get rid of. You can within yourselves have such a good system and support one another, you don't need mortgages. We were talking the other day and this topic came up. We said, just say a family of 100 people, relatives, if you decided to give £1,000 one-off payment, 1,000. What's £1,000 with this for a family today? £100,000 you have in an account for your brother that comes from back home or your son-in-law to buy him a house? What's £1,000? But this brother will come and you have supported him in this way. And you can even say to him, brother, maybe in future pay back, no problem. But make it easy for him. But say, if you do pay back, there's no interest involved. Rather just give me the amount that was paid for. This is brotherhood. And unfortunately, we can't unite amongst ourselves, let alone globally be united, and we give it that big talk that the Muslims are disunited. Brothers are disunited in one roof. Living in one house is disunited, let alone one sky. Two brothers are living under one roof and is disunited. Women are living in one roof, disunited. Mother-in-law and sister are living in one house, disunited. What unity are we talking about? Talk about unite our own families first. And your own brothers in your community. Your neighborhood. And you know when this unity occurs, then slowly, slowly, if Allah Ta'ala brings back unity within the Muslims, then you will see Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will honor our religion. When there's disunity, look at the consequences. You know, India was ruled by half Hindus and Muslims. And you know, the greatest tool, the Western tool was, and is today even, how do we cause disunity amongst themselves? As soon as this disunity is, they will come and they will conquer and rule all over it. That's what happened in India. All this fitna started. Qadianism, so on, disunity. And look at the consequences that we face today. Where there was unity, 300 took over 1,000, 335,000 ruled 300,000, and then in India, 600 million were ruled by 1,000 British civil servants. 1,000, only 1,000. rural India. A population of how many? 600 to 700 million people. Brothers, Allah Ta'ala has given us a great gift, and that is the gift of Iman. Gift of Iman. Listen forward. Asaf. So brothers, regardless of what background we come from, end of the day, Iman and Islam is the one that unites us all. Until we don't get this dirt from our hearts, we don't remove this dirt, that so-and-so belongs to so-and-so tribe, so-and-so belongs to so-and-so country, so-and-so is this color, so-and-so is that color. Until this is not removed, brothers, we don't see no changes in our Islam, in our deen, and we don't see our deen prosper at all. This unity has caused us to be in such a state. Until we do not unite amongst ourselves, first of all, our own homes. Unless and until we don't care for our brother the way we care for our own blood brother. Unless and until we don't give preference to others, time does not allow me, but I would love to mention many other narrations that you've heard. When one guest came to Rasulullah, very briefly, one guest came to Rasulullah and he was hungry. Rasulullah said, I could not feed him. He sent him to his wife, said, we have no food. He went to another brother. Rasulullah said, is there any amongst you Sahaba that will cater for this brother? One Sahabi, Ansari Sahabi, got up and said, I will do so. He went home and he told his wife, a guest of Rasulullah has come. She says, no problem, but the thing is we have a minute amount of food. How is it going to suffice for the entire family and this guest? When the children are crying out of hunger, how are we going to give him food? He said, don't worry. Let him come at the time we begin to eat. Because there's not enough food for three, or rather two. When the time comes, he sits on the table, switch off the light, and we pretend as if we're eating along with him. And the children put them to sleep out of hunger. This is what happened. Subhanallah. Out of so much brotherhood, this guest came in and he began to eat and the light turned off by chance. And they pretended as if they're eating with alongside him. In the morning, this Sahabi came normal, Fajr namaz, Fajr salah. Rasulullah said, what did you do with your guest? He said, why? He said, because Allah Ta'ala has mentioned you in the Quran. وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً. You give preference to your brother, even though it's hardship. And look at the state of Allah. Today, forget about, we can't even invite another brother to our house to eat. We find it a big burden. We have a big burden. So-and-so guest can come. You've got money, you've got food, even then you're tired. Even then our house is not opened. How is it when you don't have nothing to eat and you call? So imagine Ramadan time, a guest comes. You'd hate to take him home with you. But these were the Sahaba Ikram radiallahu. These were great examples for us. And because of their unity, Allah Ta'ala gives such izzat to Islam that the history records that there's never been such incidents where Muslims have ruled in such minor number. May Allah Ta'ala give us the understanding.
Inshallah, as you're aware, more people than other Jummas.